إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وأزواجه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وسلم تسليمًا كثيرًا. أما بعد، we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala abundantly. And we ask Allah to exalt the mention and grant peace and send His salutations and blessings upon the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon his companions, his wives, and all those who follow them on their path of righteousness until the day of recompense. Whenever we discuss marriage, you know, you get these funny feelings, huh? In your stomach, in your heart, in your mind, and sometimes in your legs, depending on what kind of person you are. Marriage is one of these, you know, topics that can be discussed in hundreds of ways. And I think with all the kids in the background, we see a manifestation of marriage, which is bringing children into existence. So which angle are we going to tackle this from is the real question. We could discuss many things. However, the decision was made that we will deal with it in two parts. Tonight, inshallah, and tomorrow night. And we'll be dealing with like before and after. You know how they show you someone who's like 300 kilos and then he started exercising and diet, then they show you like slim and they say before and after. Marriage is not like that. It could be like that. It could be that you were fat and you became slim, or that you were slim and then you became fat. Okay? Both could happen. It depends on what you do in between. What you do between this before and after is what determines whether this marriage will be a source of success in your life, prosperity, betterment of your social life, and even economical life, and ultimately the life to come, or the other way around. For some people, marriage is the worst decision they've ever made. And it's the time when things started going in the opposite direction. Why? Because marriage wasn't approached properly. Because in many cases, culture is what determines how we deal with the spouses before and after. And whenever human beings turn away from the commandments of Allah and His legislation and assume that whatever other alternative is better, this is the first sign of destruction for that nation. Whether that nation is Muslims or non-Muslims. Because Muslims fall into the same trap of thinking, yeah, I know this is what Islam teaches, but back home, brother, back home, you know, the way we do it is that ABC. And so they know that Islam says something other than back home, but back home. It's like back home is that thing which you cannot go against. It's that rule as if it's been revealed, as if it's wahi. And so we treat it in a way where we give it significance and importance more than the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. And then we expect barakah. Then we wonder, how come this didn't work, and how come this, and how come that? Well, look at what we did in the beginning. Had we followed the Islamic instructions and guidelines in regards to the relationship between the husband and wife, or what are to be husband and wife, meaning before marriage, engagement, and what leads to that, and after, then very rarely would you actually have a problem. The only time there would be a problem is when this is just the qadr of Allah, that your test in life would be in marriage. There are times when you actually follow the you know, universal legislation and means that Allah provided, yet marriage becomes a conflict, because the qadr of Allah is that you would be tested. This is your test in life. Each one of us will ultimately be tested. But it's not all the same test. So Allah Azza wa Jal knows which individuals will go through what kind of test. And then that, passing that test, will determine their final destination. So an angry person's test is to control anger. And a person who's greedy, his test is to be able to discipline himself from wanting more. And the list goes on. Each one of us knows what areas he's weak in. And he sees very often that the tests which come from Allah are those related to his character, or the flaw in his character. So for some, it could be marriage, not a big deal. If it is meant to be separation at the end and divorce, قَدَّرَ اللَّهُ مَا شَاءَ فَعَلْ. The Prophet ﷺ, the wives of the Prophet ﷺ were divorced prior to burying him in cases. The Sahaba divorced their wives. Divorce existed, and Allah made this as a final outlet for unsuccessful marriages. Some people are simply incompatible. And you can try to mold them together for some time, and you can do, all kinds of counseling and so on and so forth, but it's not meant to happen. So what we want to focus on is how do we ensure that the steps which you are taking towards marriage are per the sunnah. So that in case it doesn't work out, we will not blame ourselves. We will not be blameworthy for having not followed the instructions. And if it works out, which is ultimately what we all look for, then alhamdulillah, we will see in our lives the fruits and the benefits of following the sunnah. This cannot happen unless we have a aqidah. When we speak about aqidah, you think, okay, aqidah is asma'u sifat, and tawheed al-rububiyyah, and tawheed al-uluhiyyah, fantastic. Yes, that is an aspect of aqidah. But aqidah at the very core of it is the true belief in Allah, the true reliance on Allah, the understanding that this whole universe is being managed simultaneously with all its intricacies by Allah Azza wa Jal, no one else. And therefore Allah arranges the affairs of His slaves, and He decrees for them what is good for them, even though it may appear to be evil to us in our limited understanding of things. We think that this thing is evil, but in truth it is the ultimate good from Allah. If we don't have this foundation, we find resistance. When we don't have this foundation, we find that we go back to the issue, yeah brother, but the sunnah says, akhi, I know, but the culture says, but people back home, why? There isn't enough trust in the deen of Allah. The trust is in our forefathers. Wallah, my father did it and my mom is still there. It means that this must be the way that things work. Not necessarily. Because you can find another family where they're on the verge of separation. Or very often, the parents are, it's a failed marriage. They're only together for the kids. You know this very often. They can't even stand each other. Some I've heard where husband and wife don't even speak to each other. Okay? It's all, professional. They have a professional relationship. It's like a secretary and a mudir. He gives her instructions, she carries out her task, she has her, whatever, that's it. But they're together for the sake of the kids. But that's not what Islam wants. Islam does not want each one of the spouses to lose their right, which Allah gave them, just to be diplomatic enough to maintain the relationship for the kids. It has to be something which is healthy. So when we speak about before marriage, we have to first understand that we should get married. Okay, flat out. I say this to all the shabab, because the Prophet ﷺ said it to the shabab. Ya ma'ashar al-shabab, man istata'a minkum al-ba'ata falyatazawwaj. Oh young men, whoever amongst you can afford it, then let him get married. Now, anyone who suggests otherwise is basically suggesting something against the Prophet ﷺ. And very often, the parents' justification is correct, like the hadith. Whoever amongst you can afford it. So they say to the son, I know you're excited and everything, but you don't have a job, you haven't finished your education, and you can't look after a lady yet. And the young men have to understand the validity of this position. Your parents are not trying to complicate your life, but they already went through the stages of life and having to take care of a family, where they learn that it's not as easy as you think. You think, it will work out. Allah will bless it. Somehow I will find. No. Islam, first you tie your camel and then you rely upon Allah. You have to follow the means. What are the means you have for opening a house, as they say in Arabic, tiftah bayt, and to the bottle. Leave the bottle alone, please. Huh? To look after a wife and have kids when you yourself is still a kid, in a sense. Do you realize what's at stake? You don't. Therefore, calm down. Yes, we're encouraging marriage when you are ready. Now, if you are the father and you got some fulus, don't be stingy. A father, and this is known, it used to be this way, a father will take care of his son from A to Z. If he's got money like that, say, don't worry, it's on me. I'll get you married, I'll help you settle down, and then you'll be able to maintain and so on and so forth. So if the father has wealth wherein he can help his son, then that condition of being able to look after is no longer an issue. So the parents have a responsibility towards helping their children getting married. And the young men and women have a responsibility towards seeking that in the lawful means and knowing when they are ready. Not every time you are in love, you are ready. And not every time you reach puberty, you are ready. This is one of the signs of maturity. Maturity is way beyond that. This is something we have to understand. I'm saying this, you may say, what is he talking about? Because when we discuss this with the Shabab, we see that there's a zeal and excitement about getting married, but you can tell already this person is not ready for that. And then you don't want to begin your life with a, you know, kind of a bad move and then have to pay for it for the rest of your life. Specifically, if a child is brought into existence and then there's a division, who is he going to be, you know, with his mom or his dad, and who will look after him, and you still have to pay for his expenses even though you yourself haven't finished school. It's a long process, very complicated. So get married if you can. If you can. Once you have a job, you can pay rent and you can pay for food, you're pretty much ready to go. Okay, you don't have to be a well-established businessman with a Mercedes parked outside and a villa and a few properties in your name to say, well, okay, it's about time now to get married. This is a millionaire. Okay, the average person should be able to get married because, you know, spending on your wife, unless you, you know, I don't know who you would marry, but unless she's some princess or something, it's not going to be a big deal. Okay, some clothing here and there and some food to eat and life is simple. Get married as soon as possible. Now, when you do get married, what do you look for? No one knows, huh?
Righteous.
Huh?
Righteous.
Righteous?
Righteousness.
Righteousness. Who agrees with the brother? All of you agree? Type anything else? Type she's righteous. Huh? Fasting? You know, because of the situation, I can't really comment on this one, but if she's fasting, you're going to have a lot of problems. You know what I'm saying? I mean, yes, maybe later on, during Ramadan, inshallah, you can fast. But that's not what you look for in the beginning. In fact, they advise you not to get married in Ramadan, for reasons. Yes?
Character.
Huh? Character, okay. Beauty. Now, we have to understand why a woman is married. And the Prophet ﷺ stated clearly, that, you know, تُنْكَحُ الْمَرْآةَ لِأَرْبَعَ. A woman is married for four reasons. Her lineage. She comes from a family that is you know, decent family. You may say, what is the relevance of that? Well, this is what people usually look for because that can simplify your life and other things. Okay, it doesn't mean that that's what you're looking for, but that's among the means of facilitation. Or she gets married, someone marries her for her dinero, huh? Dollars, pesos, whatever currency that you prefer. I don't work for any currency converters, but you know, people get married for money. Now, of course, this is a horrible thing to do, right? Even though it happens, you don't really want to do that because as a man, you look silly. You know, because you are at the mercy of this lady, hoping that she will spend on you. And then if she doesn't spend on you, what are you going to do, right? So if you don't have enough money to be able to look after and she decides not to spend, because she has the right not to spend a riyal, okay? The woman has no share in expenses in marriage, zero. If she gives something out of the goodness of her heart, jazakallahu khairan. But technically, Islamically, she doesn't have to pay for anything. Which just on a side note, the whole thing of a dowry being paid by the woman and her family to the brother, because if he's a doctor, it's this much, and if he's an engineer, it's that much, and all that stuff. This is, you know, twisting Islam and culture in a very horrible way. This cannot be accepted in Islam. A woman doesn't pay dowry to a man, inshallah, he is the most qualified creature on earth. It's his job to pay for the dowry. If they give him a gift as an oven or a stove or a microwave, that's nice of them. But he shouldn't be getting an actual payment or the whole furniture on the expense of the family, and he doesn't pay anything. So you look for a woman with usually women are looked for wealth, if she has wealth. This is what the tunkah al-mar'a. These are the reasons why men marry women. The third one is her beauty. Her beauty. Now, beauty is relevant. When we say beauty, don't think about magazines and don't think about models and don't think about all these people whom we have been forced to believe that they are the representation of beauty. These are people that are Hollywood or Bollywood or whatever you want to call it. This is all a whole nother. The real life, as they say, beauty is in the eye of the beholder. Khalas. You know, to her, he's handsome. Alhamdulillah. Don't dwell into this issue and discuss it too much. And vice versa. If she's your type, end of story. If you're going to be looking for a particular lady with specific looks that you saw in one of the singers or one of the actresses you saw on TV, then you're going to keep searching for some time. Huh? Even Google can't help you with this one. Many options, but you're making it tough for yourself, man. So, keep it real. A lady that is khalas, alhamdulillah. Doesn't have to be any beauty within average. But the most important thing we look for is dini. The woman should be married for a religious commitment. Then the Prophet ﷺ made a deen, فَظْفَرْ بِذَاتِ الدِّينِ تَرِبَتْ يَدَكْ. Then hold on and grab, make sure that you acquire the one with the religious commitment. May your hands be rubbed with dust. This dua, scholars interpret it different ways, whether the Prophet ﷺ is making dua that Allah increases your wealth, or that he's warning you if you don't do this that you will run out of wealth. Either way, this is not the point of discussion. The conclusion is, we should look for the woman who is religiously committed. Why? Why? What's the benefit of a religiously committed woman? Let's say she doesn't have beauty at that level that you dreamt about, and she doesn't have a lot of money, nor is she from this fancy lineage or family. She's just a regular lady. What is the benefit of her being religiously committed? How does that add value to your life? Yes?
The other three eventually run out.
The other three eventually run out. Sometimes they increase, especially money. Huh? But that's a good observation. Yeah, beauty will eventually run out when you get old. And that, there's no way of stopping that. Lineage, that maybe the family will suffer from something, so their name will be kind of tarnished in their reputation. And obviously the money, that's questionable. It may increase, she may inherit her parents, so she becomes richer, right? Or it may go away. But truly, the one that ultimately remains is the religious commitment. What else?
Patience.
Huh? Children. At the end of the day, you need a mother who will look after your children. But she's beautiful and she has no religious commitment. And so your daughter's going to turn out to be, all day she's wearing makeup and, that's all she knows about this life. Tell her, recite Surah Al-Ikhlas, and she will recite for you, oops, I did it again. Why, Wallah? Because the mother is all about, Britney Spears and, all these losers that she sees on TV. So the daughter is going to be like the mother. So what benefit did you get from this beautiful lady? Nothing. You have a problem. When you travel, you go outside. If you don't have a religiously committed wife, you will suffer as a man. If the woman is not faithful to her husband, what can you imagine? You cannot even imagine the stress that the husband might go through if he knows that his wife is the flirtatious type of woman. Because if she's not religiously committed, her brother-in-law comes in, she welcomes him home, she welcomes him at home, the neighbor comes in, he comes into the house, and we're easygoing people, we don't have all these restrictions of mixing, everything goes. Well, what will happen to you? You know that a strange man is in your house, and you're outside of the country. That when you have a religiously committed woman who knows that these are red lines which she cannot cross, you can go for months with a peace of mind that your wife is faithful to you because she fears Allah. Even if you're not there to see her, she knows Allah sees her and the angels are writing down what she's doing. So that will make her refrain from doing anything which will jeopardize that marriage. And the benefits of having a righteous wife cannot be enumerated in one lecture, honestly. But I'm emphasizing this so we will understand how critical it is to look for that quality. And in all honesty, very often, the one that you met on Facebook is not that one. The one that you met on some matrimonial website is not that one. The one that has already pictures which have been seen by half of the people on earth. Because how many people on Facebook? Huh? One image can circulate how many? That one that was seen by half of the people on earth is probably not that one. Honestly, for the brothers and for the sisters. The one that you're looking for might have Facebook, but she's not the one who's on Facebook herself. Not her face on the book. She's just posting some Islamic material. She's, you know, doing her thing. She might have a business. We're not saying you only have to use Facebook for Islam. You can use it for some halal worldly purpose. But if it's other than that, if she has all these guys on her friends list, then you're already on the wrong page, akhi. Because, you know, that will have to continue afterwards. You think she's ready after she marries you. Yani, mashallah, Mr. I don't know what to call you. She's willing to give up all this for you. Truthfully speaking, most women are not. Because she will say, what, you're going to change my life? You met me like this. That's the first thing she would tell you. You have no problem. You met me through Facebook. Now suddenly Facebook is a problem. So you will have a dead end there that you cannot deal with. Therefore, being selective from the beginning is critical. What is the best way to do it? Word of mouth. The most successful means of finding a righteous wife is word of mouth. People that know people that know people that have a lady that is known for being righteous. She's the one that you usually have not seen before or might have seen in one family visit or some occasion where you had a glance at her and khalas, that was it. And then you realize that this is someone who might be your type. And then you spoke to your parents, you spoke to her parents, and you followed the right channel to get married. This is probably the one that you're looking for in terms of righteousness. Because today, we have a misconception about righteousness. Righteousness became just a light word that anyone says or claims. And khalas, we assume that there's righteousness. Righteousness is a lot more than that. Specifically in the case of the sisters. You can measure the righteousness of the sister per her modesty. If she is modest, there's righteousness. If there's no modesty, there's no righteousness. Evidence, I can give you a whole lectures that you can get on your own from any source, from the Quran and the Sunnah, about how Allah described the believing women who are considered righteous. قَانِتَاتٌ حَافِظَاتٌ لِلَّهِ بِمَا حَافِظَاتٌ بِالْغَيْبِ لِمَا حَفِظَ اللَّهِ Allah Azza wa Jalla described them that they are qanitat, they are in the state of submission, meaning to Allah Azza wa Jal first and then to their husbands, and then they protect and preserve in their absence of their husband per the command of Allah Azza wa Jal what should be preserved and protected. So she's looking after your pocket, she's looking after your well-being, she's looking after your health, she's looking after your mother, she's looking after your father, she cares about your family. Not the one who tells you from day one it's either me or your mother. Choose. You know, if she says that, honestly, in the nicest way, say, you see that door over there? Yeah. Right there. Yeah. See you later. And call your mom on the phone. Once a lady tries to put herself in competition with your mom, know that she's crazy. She must be crazy. How in the world are you going to forsake your mother, whom Allah Azza wa Jal, you know, commanded you in the Quran and in tens of ayat to look after her for some lady that you didn't know until you got married? The mother who bore you and looked after you and nursed you and changed your diaper and was worried about you all your life. All this you're going to throw in the ocean because of some lady you met 2 weeks ago? So know that this is already the first step towards destruction. The ladies cannot possibly compete with the mother. It doesn't mean that you also become, you know, you lose your manhood in a sense that whatever your mom says gets done even if it's wrong and you don't know how to manage your mother versus your wife. You have to know how to manage. You're a businessman. So at home, you're a political person. Yes, your mom may tell you something that you know is not good, so you know how to work it out with your mom. Because some husbands also don't have no mind. His mother said, then he does. But his wife gets victimized in the process and she's innocent. His mother-in-law, you know, his mother has issues. Just keeping it real. So you have to know where to strike the balance to give each their rights. But never should a woman compete with your mother. Once you see this being the case, then you know it's wrong. So she has to look after your wealth, she after your health, and after your family members. And she has to help you in your deen. If you are heedless and she is heedless with you, no good. When you are heedless, she should remind you of Allah, hey, you know this is haram. Why haven't you done this? And this is how the woman of the Salaf used to be. She would tell him before he leaves the house, fear Allah. Fear Allah regarding us and do not earn anything haram. We are better off starving, dying out of starvation rather than putting in our stomachs that which Allah made unlawful. Versus a woman who today say, do anything. Rob the neighbors. Just make sure that you buy me this new couch which I saw at IKEA. Ma, yeah, lady, what happened to helping me get closer to Allah? No, she doesn't know. As long as you're making money, inshallah, you work in any place that is full of haram, the lady has no concern whatsoever. For the Quran or for me? Oh, be careful, you may get a virus on my camera. I'm telling you, man, sometimes people took pictures and didn't work afterwards. Anyways, I'm just on the joke, honestly. Being pictures is a long story. So you've reached that point where you've done the homework, you know, your family knew someone who's good and righteous, inshallah. And now you want to begin this relationship. How do you begin? You send her a text message, WhatsApp to save money. It's free. Look for some Wi-Fi somewhere. Hey, here's a free network. Send a WhatsApp message, starting off, mashallah, with the generosity. Now, how do you begin? Assuming your father and your mother, they went to her parents and said, you know, our son, mashallah, is interested in your daughter. And they said, okay, ma fi mushkila, I think we can work this out. And now you know that there's a potential marriage there. And you are now to communicate with this lady, or maybe not, it's up to you. In regards to this issue, what do you think would be lawful? Let's speak about lawful. What do you think would be halal for you to do? See her. MashaAllah. Is he correct? Yes. If you haven't seen her, of course. If you haven't seen her. If you've seen her, don't go see her again. Let me just double check. Sheikh, you've seen her 15 times, Allah hadith. You think she's going to look different on the 16th time? Maybe. Well, actually, maybe. Huh? All the makeup before has gone now. But if she's wearing makeup already, you know. Anyways, so the bottom line is, see her. It's the sunnah to actually see the woman. Why? Because you don't want any surprises. You don't. And the sisters don't want any surprises either. Because, you know, you can act. Every one of us can put on an act for 5-10 minutes, you know, slick and everything. But when all the doors are closed and you are home alone, you know you're somebody else. Right? All the things which we don't do in public, we do when we are not in public. And usually your spouse becomes someone who is not public. Right? It's your own family. So you don't want to be surprised at any point. Therefore, look. And it's Islamic and it's legal for you to visit the place. And now the scholars have differed to what extent can you look at her or to what can she or she cannot show you. So some of them say she can, you know, show you anything. Not anything, anything. But I'm saying, like, you know, she can, you know, be wearing, you know, regular, you know, some clothing and so on and so forth with no hijab. Some of them say, no, she has to be wearing the hijab, but if she wears niqab, she doesn't wear the niqab. Some of them allow that you see the hands. Some of them do not allow that you see the hands. There's a scholarly difference of opinion. I'm not going to elaborate on that now in order not to impose one fiqhi position over the other. Okay? So whatever is agreeable to you and you think is halal in the deen of Allah, not because it meets your desires, then this is the position which you follow. But assuming that you're allowed to see her hair, which is a very common position, you're allowed to see her face and her hair and her hands. Then you go ahead and you do so. But never would you be in seclusion with her. There's no, well, you know, we'll go to this one room where we get to know each other and you sit next to each other and everybody's all, you know, shy and butterflies in your heart and everything. Because you will fall in love definitely, even if there's nothing to love. Shaitan, this is where he's been waiting for a long time for this opportunity. You have to understand, this is the time for him to get to strike. So you'll find that once, even if she's anything, no matter what the situation, you will feel something. You will feel this, you know, it will tickle you inside. And that is not necessarily good. Why? Because you may, in that state, make the wrong decision. Initially, you really didn't like her or you whatever, but because of that gathering, you feel shy now. Very often, it happens. We don't want to offend them. And if they tell me why, I say I didn't like it, say, يعني مشي حالك, I don't want to look bad and hurt her feelings. Yalla, we'll go for it. But you did not want to go for it in the beginning. No, this marriage is a time when you have to be firm. You don't like her, just go. Her feelings will get hurt, she will get over it. And another one will come along who will not feel the same way as you, and she will live happily ever after with him. But don't be worried about her feelings to the extent that you wind up making a move that you know that you were not ready for. So you look at her with the presence of family members. Preferably she brings you the tea or the coffee or the juice or whatever that is. And then you see her while she's coming. Then you'll see her as she goes away. And khalas. Don't go chasing after, say, listen, I want to tell you something. What about that thing? You know, it's none of that stuff. Huh? Maintain your distance. Now that you found, let's say you found that she's attractive to you. The next thing to do is get married. As soon as possible. Because some people have this perception that we have to get to know each other, you know. Make sure that we both like the same food and we like the same, I don't know what. And we, yeah, Sheikh, you know, all this is worthless. Ask married couple. The whole issue of loving the same food will make no difference because cooking is a matter of tawfiq from Allah. Either she will make the right meal that will taste good, even if it's not your type of food, or she will make horrible food, even if you thought that she was the best one to make that food. Now, there are times when she forgot the salt, you know, shaker in the food, or there are times when the food is not going to work. So this whole thing of making sure I like green, she likes green, oh wow, what cute, I think we're going to live, you know, have the best life because we both love green. Who cares, man? Green or brown? This is a color, man. Food and all this stuff is a waste of time. Evidence, ask, you know, the non-Muslims who've been going out for 20 years. Dating for 20 years. They know each other inside out. Then they got married. A month later, they divorced. If you've been for 20 years going out with each other, what made you divorce? You know each other so well. Because it's not about how long you've known this person. It's about the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, Al-arwahu junudun mujannada. Al-arwahu junudun mujannada. Souls are like soldiers. Some of them are compatible, they find repose in each other, and some of them are repelled. Some of them, ikhtalaf, they will differ. Khalas, they just don't click. You know, you meet someone and from day one, you know, this is a person I can be a friend. This is someone that you can share with them your deepest secrets. And you meet another person, you know that it's going to be a superficial relationship. Someone that you may say, give salams to because you see him in the masjid. But he's not the type of person that you click with. Why? Because the arwah are junud mujannada. So if you find that lady, khalas, you found that one moment of connection, then the next thing to do is what? The one who gives me the right answer, I will give him nothing. Yes, sir. Here's nothing. Barakallah feek. I don't have anything to give him. Istikhara. Many people forget about istikhara. Without istikhara, it will be a khasara. What is khasara? Loss. No istikhara. What is istikhara? Istikhara is a divine guidance from Allah that you cannot purchase with money. You cannot go to a counselor, you cannot refer to an expert, with the people. No one can help you in this regard because it has to do with qadar. It has to do with the unseen. It has to do with the future. Who knows the future and the qadar except Allah? No one. So the Prophet ﷺ taught us that إِذَا هَمَّ أَحَدُكُمْ بِالْأَمْرِ. If one of you has already the intention to do something, himma is that conviction or determination. You've already decided, okay, I'm going to marry Fulana, her name is Maryam, whatever. Okay? Once you've made that decision, but you don't know whether it's good or not, you pray 2 rak'at voluntary. It could be tahiyyat al-masjid, it could be the sunnah of fajr, any 2 rak'at that are voluntary. Or you can pray specifically for that intention. And as soon as you conclude the salah, some of the scholars say at the end of the salah, before the tasleem, some say after the salah. Either way, there's flexibility. You make this dua. Even if I said it now, you won't memorize it. So I'll give you the solution. I have it on my website first, and I have a special video on YouTube for the istikhara with the text in Arabic, English, and transliteration, which is the English letters of the Arabic text. Like when you say SubhanAllah, you write S-U-B, so on and so forth. And then you can find it in a nice book called Husn al-Muslim, The Muslim Fortress. It's a very cheap, everybody has it. It's available in English. You have to learn this dua. You have to memorize this dua and you have to apply this dua. The summary of the dua basically is saying what you're saying in more or less, Oh Allah, you know and I don't know. You know and I don't know. And based on this foundation, which is Allah knowing and you not knowing, then you mention that affair. If this affair, marrying Maryam, is good for me, fi dini, in my religion, huh? And in my worldly affair, in my deen, in my worldly affair, wa aqibati amri, and in the outcome of the affairs as well, huh? Then write it for me, decree it for me, and bless it for me, wa barik li fihi. And if this affair is not good for me, not in my deen, not in my dunya, not in the outcome of my affairs, then distance, make a distance between me and that thing. Separate between me and that thing. And give me something else which is better for me and make me pleased with it. Beautiful dua. Once you've made it, just move like a train. Once you've made that dua, don't wait for a dream. Because you hear wild things. Brother, I made this istikhara that I saw that I was eating strawberry ice cream in a dream. What does that mean? That you like strawberry ice cream? I don't know, man. I'm not a dream interpreter first. Secondly, what does that have to do with anything? Well, maybe because, you know, she likes pink and I saw strawberry. It's a sign from Allah that the ice cream... Yeah, Shaykh, this is not istikhara, barakallahu fi. You can see in the dream you could have been thinking about ice cream for so long that you dream about ice cream. You're going to base your whole marriage and success over ice cream? Not a good idea. Istikhara has nothing to do with dreams. This is a misconception among the Muslims. There's no dream involved. The hadith is clear. فَيَسِّرْهُ لِي Facilitate this matter for me. So if you make that dua, and then next thing you know, mashallah, they were looking for a hall to book, and they weren't able to find any in your local city, next thing you know, they find a booking. And they said, no, she will not get married until her grandfather comes from our home country. Next thing you know, he found a ticket and he's on his way. When you see the matter as being facilitated, khalas, this is the answer for your istikhara. And vice versa. If they start putting conditions that they didn't have before and they start getting picky with you, no, this one we didn't agree and this one that, and you see it's a dead end, then this is the answer from Allah. Don't be upset. Don't say, man, this was the perfect woman for me. No, it wasn't. Had it been the perfect woman for you, Allah would have decreed this marriage to take place. The fact that Allah Azza wa Jal distanced you from that thing is a sign from Allah. So this is where aqeedah comes in, where you feel at ease. Alhamdulillah, qaddar Allah ma sha fa'al. Next. If you had been following the Islamic rules and it didn't work out, it will be very easy for you to go for next. If you did not, and the poor husband and wife, or what could have been husband and wife, fell in love, it becomes disastrous when it doesn't work out. Suddenly the parents become an obstacle, and you're like, but I love her. And she says, but I love him. And no, and I cannot do this, and I cannot marry another man, and blah, blah, blah. And her father then forces her to marry another man. So now, poor brother, I feel bad for that brother, who the sister married while she's still in love with the one her parents didn't approve of. So your heart is divided and her heart is divided, and the other husband is a victim of his wife being in love with another man because she had fallen in love with him before she met him, because she only married him because her father forced her. Long story. But at the end of the day, look at the disasters that will come as a result of not following the rules. That's the issue of premature love. So you say, but akhi, we're engaged and you know we're supposed to be able to communicate. Say, yeah, that's logically what you think is good for you. But the more you communicate, the more you're going to find in common. That's just the way it is. People who used to chat, you know, when chatting first came out, they were loving people wholesale. Wallah wholesale. Every lady he chats with, three lines. After three lines, she's the one. Then he meets another one, then she's the one. And another one, and she's the one. How many are you going to get married? You can only get four. But he loves now many, many women upon earth. Why? Because because wallah they found in, again we have these things in common. So if you were to take that route, you will suffer at the end. So Islam came for our own good. Yes, there's an engagement, but keep your distance. Deal with logistics, deal with numbers. We need to buy this place, we need to rent this place. Involve the family members, be professional, so that the relationship is healthy. Until you get married, then we will tell you, love all you want. Which usually, you know, sometimes works the other way around. But until you marry, if you're not married, don't go that route. Why? You will suffer the most when it doesn't work out. So we have to understand the wisdom and the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal towards the creation when needed that. طيب, let's say you successfully found this young lady or old lady, and you know, you decided to get married. We Muslims, may Allah rectify our condition, have invented many things that are abhorrent. And we attribute them to Islam with ease and with a peace of mind, like, yeah, this is definitely part of Islam. Who can name at least one innovation, especially if you've watched previous lectures, who can name one innovation which is common in Islamic marriages or nikah or whatever you want to call it today? Surah Al-Fatiha, mashallah, mashallah. Ma'lish, let's be honest. All of those who have this, you know, cultural event, let's call it that, back home, raise your hand. How many of you actually have Fatiha recited when two people get married? Only three? That's an awesome crowd. Okay, 4, 5, 6, that's more like it. In the Middle East, by the way, in case you're not from the Middle East, obviously, this is the norm. The actual event is called Fatiha. They say we recited the Fatiha, meaning this is means of bringing them together. I'm not going to do the whole Egyptian and all the various Arabic accents just because we're in the masjid right now. But at the end of the day, this whole thing of Fatiha does not belong in marriage. Fatiha, sadly, with its virtue, we have many ahadith about the virtues of Surah Al-Fatiha. It's a ruqya, it's a spiritual remedy. It's called Ummul Kitab. It has many virtues. But one of them, or definitely none of them, is fill in the blanks. And for many Muslims, the Fatiha is fill in the blanks. Anytime they don't know what the Sunnah teaches, then they put Fatiha. So someone dies, Fatiha for the dead. And they go to the grave, Fatiha. And they want to get married, Fatiha. This is because they don't know the Sunnah that they're supposed to apply. So they made the Fatiha this one, you know, key, master key, which opens all the locks. But why are you doing this when Islam already gave us instructions about these very events? We know the dua of going to the graveyard. And we know the dua of the deceased and for the deceased. And regarding marriage, we know that we have khutbat al-hajah, the one which you hear the imam reciting usually every Jum'ah. إِنَّ الْحَمْدَ لِلَّهِ نَحْمَدُهُ وَنَسْتَعِينُهُ وَنَسْتَغْفِرُهُ وَنَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ. Until the end of it, this is actually the sunnah during nikah. That the one who's conducting this marriage, you know, this marriage, he recites khutbat al-hajah upon the people. And then they go through the, you know, offering the lady and the qabool, the acceptance and so on and so forth with the two witnesses and her guardian. Her guardian. Not someone you met down the street. And you just wanted to expedite the marriage, hold our father back home, and if we tell him right now, he will not understand. So, yeah, you, excuse me, can you please come here and be the guardian for this lady? Here's 100, you know, riyals. Oh, ma fi mushkila. And you get the marriage done. This is zina. This is zina. This is you making for yourself a woman lawful for you that is unlawful in the deen of Allah. Until her guardian, which is her father, if he were to be alive, or her grandfather, if he's not alive, or her son, if she's been previously married, or then the uncle. We have in Islam an actual tree of who to go to when one is not present. It has to be through the guardian. So you follow the sunnah by giving khutbat al-hajah and then you get married. طيب, dowry. We already spoke about the dowry being, you know, a serious issue in many cases. But the hadith in Bayhaqi from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, خَيْرُ الصُّدَاقِ أَيْسَرُ. The best dowry is the most facilitated one. Another hadith, he said, عليه السلام, خير النكاح أي سلام. And the best marriage contract, or the best marriage, is the one which is facilitated. So we call on the parents and on the potential husbands and wives. Simplify your life. Simplify your life. When you're about to get married, all this excessive preparation, this extravagance in spending, renting the most expensive halls and bringing the most, you know, expensive food. It has to be from five-star hotel and imposing all kinds of, you know, pressures on the parents. It makes marriage horrible. And you know, for many men, they run away from marriage because marriage to him is this mountain that he can't seem to climb. With all these hurdles and obstacles that have been placed in the way of the person, it's like, for me to get married, I have so many things to do. This is not Islam. The Prophet ﷺ, the most which was paid in him getting married or giving his daughter in marriage was 135 riyals. Did you hear that? That phone. 135 riyals is to get married or to give his daughter in marriage. In case someone said he was saving, لا قدر الله وحشر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, that he was, he didn't have money, so he paid them. When he's giving his daughter in marriage, then he would have asked for something high. No, whether he himself paid dowry or he received, it wasn't more than 135. We say, okay, according to the standards back then, that was actually something. So does that mean that today you go looking for the 135 riyals, you will never get married? Telling you from now, huh? Don't go stand at the door and say, wallahi, 135 riyal is a sunnah. Huh? If you ask for one extra riyal, wallah, I'm not getting married. They will say, great, don't get married. We don't want you anymore either. Because, you know, nowadays it doesn't cut it. So there's a balance. There's a balance. Neither do we go for this massive amount of money, nor do we, you know, ask for something that may not be acceptable culturally. Because here Islam is, it understands the urf, what is known as urf. Urf is taken into consideration as long as it is within limitations. And Allah mentioned in the Quran that if you had given them a qintar, which is a whole lot of money, then don't take it back, which was used as an evidence that you may give a woman a lot of money in dowry. But the best one is the one which is easy and facilitated for the whole event. You don't want to fall into tabdhir. إِنَّ الْمُبَدِّرِينَ كَانُوا إِخْوَانَ الشَّيَاطِينَ. Verily, the extravagant people are the brothers of the shayateen. Would you accept it if someone said, your brother is a shaitan, and you are shaitan's brother? Is that okay? Or would you be offended? You'd be offended, say, excuse me, what? What did you say? I'm a brother of a shaitan. A'udhu billahi, shaykh, what's going on? I'm your brother. So that must be you, the shaitan. Because I'm a brother of the shaitan, so he's still going back and forth fighting. No, this is not acceptable. But according to the ayah, that the mubadhirin are brothers of the shayateen in this regard. In terms of spending, overspending for things that shouldn't be spent on, it is a form of extravagance and it is a quality of the shaitan, wa'iyadhu billah. So we have to be moderate in our spending. Get married with what is affordable. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam also said in a hadith of Ibn Majah, collected by Ibn Majah, narrated by Aisha, he said, one of the signs of a woman being blessed or blessed is that the process of proposing to her is made easy. One of the signs that there's a barakah in this particular lady is that the process of proposing has been made easy. It's an easy thing, it's not a complicated thing. So the battery died. Okay, just checking the time. And we're almost there. We're almost there. Once you have reached a point where you have the nikah, now this is a lengthy discussion, and I will not go into the steps and engagement and, you know, all this stuff. What is nikah and what is zawaj? Because we have, according to the culture, all kinds of names for all kinds of events. And some people do like 3-4 marriages. One at the expense of the mother or the parents, the wife's parents, and the other one on the expense of the father's parents, and one overseas for the uncles, and one down the street for the neighbors, and every other day they're getting married. Khalas. One will do the job. You get married once, and then you marry. And then you don't want to spend any more money on stuff that already has been fulfilled. You want to spend money on furnishing your house and, you know, doing and preparing for the future and things of the sort. So all these, you know, multiple events being done in the name of nikah, we should, you know, stick to the sunnah. There's the concept of engagement in Islam. Like Aisha radhiallahu anha at some point was engaged to someone prior to her marriage to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, before he married alayhi salatu wasalam. And we have other incidents that endorse the idea of engagement. But like we said, the engagement, it should be expedited, the process, and there's a limitation in the communication between the two. They are total strangers until they actually marry. But once the actual wedding takes place, then you shouldn't have a mixed crowd, gendered marriage. Don't bring everybody and put them in the same room and say, yalla, let us, you know, celebrate, and she comes out with full makeup and everything. It's like, what happened? That's the same one I was wearing niqab yesterday. Yeah, but it's her marriage, you know? Come on, brother, it's the wedding night. When are you extremists going to take it easy? Never. Yeah, even on the wedding night, you want her to cover herself? What was she covering herself for then before? Was it because it wasn't a wedding? Now maybe she was only covering because it wasn't a wedding night and waiting for the wedding night to remove the cover. But the rules of Allah apply across the board. There's no leeway that she exposes her beauty in front of strange men and relatives, wallah, because it's marriage. It's her wedding night. You are about to begin a very serious relationship wherein you are in dire need of the blessings of Allah. You are in dire need of the tawfiq of Allah, the support of Allah. We begin the whole thing with sin, then we want facilitation. This is a major misconception. So you have to be firm. You have to be firm. You have two places, one for the men, one for the women. So the lady can, because a woman has to look good on her wedding night. Don't blame her. She has to put the makeup and all the funky stuff, and she has to have something hanging from her head and something flying from the side and six people dragging things behind her and people throwing rice or chicken or flowers on her or whatever. You know, here's that wing right there. For you, no ruin. People do all kinds of, depending on the culture, they do throw food. Some people throw rice and lentils and, you know, peas and so on and so forth. Let them do their thing. Let her do her thing amongst women. Amongst women. Not in the presence of the other men. And you with the brothers, do your thing. Now, the ladies can beat a duf, huh? They can have a drum. Not the drum with the bells and everything, just the duf, the most plain kind of drum. And they can beat it. It's a sunnah for them to beat the drum. And one of the young ladies, a bunch of young ladies can sing. Can sing something that is halal. Okay, don't bring some, you know, wicked song of one of these singers of nowadays and sing it to the crowd. You sing something about poetry or something about good character, about morality, things of the sort. ما في مشكلة. This is all within the boundaries of Islam. Okay? And this is for the ladies. For the brother, you're not going to be beating any deaf, nor are you going to be shaking your waist. Okay? And this is strictly for the ladies. Because some brothers get excited more than their wives. She's the one sitting and he's the one dancing. What's going on with you, man? What are you going to do then later on? If this is on the wedding night, Allah istur, at home, what's going to happen? And maybe he's a break dancer. So the bottom line is, the brother, you need to calm down and keep you cool and, you know, see the brothers and kiss them and have, you know, have a good time, eat, drink something. But we, you know, just simplify. And then don't make it such a lengthy stay wherein by the time they get home, they fall asleep. Okay? I will not explain why. So make this thing short. Okay? Begin after Isha for a couple of hours, you know, by midnight maybe max, khalas. Then let the two, you know, go home and go home. And you go home as well. Because some people say, well, you'll go with them and spend the first few hours. Khalas, you know, later, you can visit me next week. Especially some relatives. La abadan wallah, her aunt. Allah, I have to be with him. Sheikh, how you do this? I'm telling you, bro, you want to ruin that camera, man, you were good the first time. Tayyib. Anyways, this could really take much longer, but I know that there are time limitations and I'm sure you have many questions. So really, that's a summarized version. Now, if you want the longer version of what I've said tonight, it's actually in a few lectures. One of them is, where is this wedding heading? Huh? You can tell by the title what this discussion is about. Where is this wedding heading? So you watch this lecture, it will give you more details about nikah and how to go through the nikah and the shurut of the marriage and many different things which are more technical that maybe the time now does not allow to elaborate on, inshallah. And bi-idhnillah, tomorrow night we will be continuing with after. You know, now that that has happened, the marriage, how do you deal with each other once you are under the same roof without, you know, being at each other's necks and driving each other crazy? Inshallah, that we will try to address tomorrow night. So, Zakumullah khairan wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad.